if people come in, they'll come in.
Okay.
But I was told I was going to be introduced, so I'll be quiet for a bit.
I get the honor of introducing Derek. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the spring session of Vallejo Choral Society's 103rd season. So good to see you all, and great to have you with us for this special evening. It's my honor to introduce our presenter this evening. Derek Tam is a distinguished director and conductor, as well as a preeminent historical keyboardist who performs regularly as a soloist and with renowned groups throughout the Bay Area. In addition to his role as artistic director for Vallejo Choral Society, Derek serves as the director of music at First Church Berkeley, producing a critically lauded performance series there. And he is the executive director of the San Francisco Early Music Society. So please welcome Derek Tam.
Thanks, Rebecca. And thank you everyone for being here and taking some time out of your evening to listen to me talk about Handel rather than listening to Handel. It looks like most of us are pretty adept and comfortable using Zoom. We'll have time after for Q&A. If there's any pressing questions, of course, feel free to put them in the chat. I'll be sharing my screen, a PowerPoint presentation, with some sound examples as we go through. So, as we took a temperature of the room earlier about Israel and Egypt, it's so nice to see that I get the chance to introduce so many of you to an amazing work that is new to you and is really dear to my heart. I've had a chance to in the orchestra before. I've never conducted it, but you know, it's just one of those works, once you listen to it, it's really an earworm and it really sticks with you. The colorfulness and the audacity of what Handel does in the work, it just captures you throughout. So in today's talk, ideally we set it up for, if you're joining us for our semester, it's going to set you up to understand the circumstances that led Handel to compose Israel and Egypt in 1738. With his operatic talents or projects beleaguered throughout the 1730s, and with himself stricken with temporary paralysis in 1737, Handel began to turn decisively to the composition of oratorio. While oratorio was a form that existed long before Handel, one could say that Handel set the example for further English language works in the genre. Handel, in short, created what we would think of as English oratorio in works like Mendelssohn's Elijah, Elgar's Dream of Durantius, maybe even looking further along, something like Michael Tippett, child of our time. You know, it's a long tradition. Along with Saul, which was composed in the same year, Israel and Egypt is, the first or the second of Handel's mature oratorios. However, there's a lot that sets it apart from Handel's later essays in the genre. And we'll also dive into the tricky topic of Handel's borrowing, some of which you might be already aware of. He borrowed a lot from himself, as well as many other composers, as we'll learn about. So now you should be able to see my screen. I'm going to get the slideshow started. Presentation's called Handel at a Crossroads. Right here we have a portrait of Handel, done around the time of the composition of Israel and Egypt by John Theodore Himes. Handel looking very good in his wig and blue suit, a proud and dignified gentleman. Don't want to presume that we know Handel's biography back and forth, but I just wanted to mention some key dates in Handel's life. He was born on February 23rd, 1685 in Halle, Saxony. According to his first biographer, John Mainwaring, you know, we can't really check these facts. His father, who was an aged doctor, was very much against Handel pursuing any career in music. You might be familiar with the story of Handel having to, you know, practice in the attic, practice an instrument called the clavichord. If you've ever played a clavichord, you know that it is frighteningly soft. You can barely hear it 2 feet away from it. So even then, Handel only did it, you know, in the dark of night as to avoid any suspicion from his father. However, at the age of seven, Handel's talents were nonetheless discovered. And Handel's father reluctantly had a partial change of heart. He said, well, you can go study music eventually if you study law. And so what Handel did at the age of seven is he began his studies with the town organist Friedrich Wilhelm Zachau, Handel's only teacher, who gave him a thorough foundation in all of the musical arts. At the same time, not only was Handel learning composition, he was also doing, of course, keyboard work. He learned to play the violin, he learned to play the oboe, you know, a burgeoning talent, if you will. As we mentioned, Handel was encouraged, quote, quote, by his father to pursue a degree in law as well, which he duly did, even after his father's death, when Handel was about, I think, 12. He attended university, got his degree in law, and promptly decided after that to move to Hamburg at the age of 18 and dive into the musical scene there. Hamburg was one of the preeminent centers for music in German-speaking lands at that time, particularly in opera. Handel encountered his first operas at Hamburg, and at the age of 20, wrote his first opera when an opportunity arose, Almira. From there, he traveled to Italy, primarily set up in Rome. We have some of his first mature works being written there. Some of you may be familiar with the Dixi Dominus, written in 1707 in Rome for the Carmelites there. Handel learned a lot in Italy. He learned, as his sometime friend Johann Mattheson would say, he learned to write for the voice. In Italy, and he took a lot of those skills and brought them to England, which he first visited in 1710 to produce a critically acclaimed opera, Rinaldo. By 1712, he had decided to stay in London / England permanently. Partially that had to do with him getting a job as the Kapellmeister to the Elector of Hanover, who would soon become King George I of England. Let's see, doing the math here, Handel became a resident, permanent resident of England when he was 27. And during the next couple of decades, most of his career was focused on opera. He was heavily involved as a co-music director and later primary music director of the Royal Academy of Music and Opera Company. In the 1730s, opera writing got a little tougher. He moved his activities to Covent Garden, which was a new theater back then. In 1737, he suffered the first of many health setbacks with a physical paralysis that went away for a bit, but would be the foreshadowing other ailments that would beleaguer him through the rest of his life. In 1742, he composed Messiah, everyone's favorite piece. In the late 1740s, early 1750s, Handel developed eye problems, which resulted in this complete blindness in 1752, unfortunately, at which point he composed his final oratorio, Jephtha. And in 1759, at the age of 74, he dies in London on April 14th. He was given a very lavish funeral with over 3,000 mourners in attendance, with a memorial dedicated to him in Westminster Abbey. So that's just a relatively quick intro to Handel's life that just gives you a little context for what we're going to talk about. Specifically, we're going to look at the 1730s. But again, the question we're trying to deal with here is, what were the circumstances surrounding the composition of Israel and Egypt? And I think part of the answer lies in the severe troubles that Handel was experiencing in his operatic ventures of the 1730s. Just acknowledging that we have a question in the chat about the paralysis, we'll address that in just a bit, I think. As we have briefly mentioned, Handel was enamored with opera from the start of his career. We can see that in him seizing the reins of writing an opera at the age of 20 with Elmira. We see him doing that with the production of Rinaldo, serving as his English calling card in 1711. It's clear that he had an affinity for Italian opera, and particularly we're talking about something called opera seria. At this point, I think it's probably good for us to define what I mean by opera seria. It's a retrospective or retroactive term. It wasn't used during the time. Like, we wouldn't, you know, like people living in the Baroque era wouldn't say, oh, we are living in the Baroque era now. It was sort of used as opera seria was kind of winding down in the late 18th century. It is defined as, you know, being opera of a serious or noble nature. An ideal plot for an opera seria would draw from the stories of antiquity and mythology, providing moral instruction as much as entertainment. So you came to be schooled as much as you came to be entertained. Tragedy was to be avoided. You wanted a happy ending where virtue would reign supreme. Sounds like TV in the 1950s or something. Reality, of course, at an opera house was much different. You know, there's still a lot of crazy stuff going on in the audience. And, you know, people went to opera seria to enjoy a great spectacle. Just think of, you know, seeing the latest, greatest film in like, you know, an IMAX theater or something, or with an enormous amount of special effects. You would go to opera to root for your favorite singer, who were paid, you know, exorbitant sums of money, regardless of what they actually sang about. You know, there were, you know, if you were in England, they sung in Italian anyways. You couldn't understand a single word they were singing for the most part. They were paid because people enjoyed their voices. In England, like in most other countries in Europe, opera seria was the province of the elite. So we're talking about the nobility, the extremely rich. And for over 20 years, Handel, by and large, set the taste for the elite. We're talking you know, just maybe a couple thousand of people here, not a huge group of people. He set the taste for this elite group through his own operas and through productions he mounted of others' works. From 1719 onward, Handel played a major role in the Royal Academy of Music, which was the first opera company devoted to promoting Italian opera in London. You know, things were going pretty swimmingly for Handel, all things considered, during the first couple years of the company, so in the early 1720s. But a rivalry between two prima donnas, Francesca Cuzzoni and Faustina Bordoni, exacerbated tensions between the academy directors and strained the company's finances as they tried to meet the salary demands of Cuzzoni and Bordoni. And in 1728, so 9 years after the Royal Academy was founded, they called it quits. They didn't have it in them to deal with the star's demands, to deal with a money-losing venture, and, you know, to deal with all those personalities. Handel and his associate, Johann Jakob Heidegger, did try to form a second academy, which went pretty well for a couple of years. But in 1733, a rival opera company called the Opera of the Nobility was formed. And this Opera of the Nobility was led by factions supporting Frederick, Prince of Wales. It'll be good for us to know that during this time, there was a big political debate between George II and his son, Frederick, Prince of Wales. They were not on speaking terms and led rival courts. And this was reflected in having two opera companies in London. You know, Handel tried his best. He was a pretty decent businessman for a musician. He transfers his activities from the King's Theater to Covent Garden. He tried to like add new attractions like organ concertos in his works. He was, you know, the operas themselves were amazing. However, the two companies were essentially bleeding each other dry. As I said, there was a pool of people who were listening to opera or paying for it. And London, the elite of London, even a wealthy elite, could not sustain two loss-making opera companies. Handel did suffer some pretty severe financial setbacks. Some biographies say that he was on the verge of bankruptcy, which is not really true, but he did suffer a lot. Let's just put it that way. At any rate, any kind of opera bickering would need to take a backseat to his sudden turn in health in 1737. Handel was a pretty private person, and we don't know exactly what happened, we know that his hand was paralyzed, and he also reported suffering from like headaches, dizzy spells, and so forth. The most likely explanation that is currently supported is saturnine gout, which is gout or the effects of lead poisoning. That, you know, there was lead everywhere. It was probably responsible for his later health issues as well. One reason that we suspected is that when he went to visit the vapor baths of Aix-la-Chapelle back on the continent, his symptoms dissipated. He just wasn't ingesting that much lead. It was a complete cure for the paralysis, but as I said earlier, it would come back, you know, there'd be other issues that would affect Handel, including his complete blindness in 1752. You can read studies on Handel's body, if you will. If you look at the pictures, Handel clearly ate and drank a lot. Some of his, you know, there's a very famous satire of him. I should have included in here just for giggles of him being caricatured as a pig by his one-time friend, Goopy. So you can look that up, Goopy, G-O-U-P-Y. It's quite a striking image. Needless to say, they weren't friends after that. Back to the story at hand, though. We've talked about all these troubles he'd had with opera. We don't know what he was actually thinking. We know nothing, you know, there's nothing documented really about his inner thoughts. And we'll never know for sure why he decisively turned from Italian opera to English oratorio, but we can surmise that, you know, that paralytic episode had a lot to do with it. It probably forced him to re-examine his ability to sustain the rigors of producing an operatic season. This is, even despite the fact that the Opera of the Nobility, that rival opera company, ceased operations late in 1737. He could have had a clear shot to becoming the only show in town again. He gave it a try. The 1737-38 season, he mounted several operas, but, you know, it turns out maybe London wasn't even a one opera company town. It was financially difficult. For the 1738-39 season, Handel's associate Heidegger just called it quits. He said on July 25th, 1738, he had failed to secure enough subscribers for the following season. And so he was going to throw in the towel. And we have evidence that the day after, July 26th, Handel began work on Saul, that first mature oratorio, followed immediately by Israel and Egypt. What did Handel have in mind when he was composing these two oratorios? Just like opera, Handel had a very long association with oratorio. He had composed two oratorios early on in his career during his time in Rome, Il Trionfo del Tempo, Il Disinganno, The Triumph of Truth and Time, as revised in the 1750s, and La Resurrezione. So he wrote two oratorios during that time in Rome. Essentially, they're like sacred concert operas. They were produced when you couldn't do a secular opera during Lent, a stage opera. You would just do everything except for the staging, make a sacred story, and then you would have an opera that you could do in Lent. Those works are quite nice. You can see Handel's dramatic flair right from the start, but, you know, also they're in Italian. But they don't really bear much resemblance to, you know, Handel's later oratorios. The first English oratorio that Handel writes is Esther in 1718. It was written during his brief stint at Canons in the service of the Duke of Chandos, Chandos, James Bridges. And Esther is really interesting work. We see that in that work written about 10 years later from Il Trionfo and La Resurrezione, that his priorities have begun to shift. There was a lot more choral music in Esther, which drew from a Latin oratorio practice. So Italian oratorios written in Latin. He also drew from German practice, the passion practice. You can think of like Bach's John Passion or Matthew Passion, or even Handel's own Bruck's Passion. There's a lot of instrumental writing in Esther. He also kind of just like became a lot more flexible with the arias. Rather than setting it in a standard operatic form, which is called da capo form, which means you have an A section, you say one thing, you say something different in the B section, and then you say the A section stuff again, but with a lot of embellishment. Rather than sticking slavishly to ABA form, he just did more what was necessary to sustain the dramatic interest. So, you know, he's trying to put all these elements together. Again, we're talking more choral music, more instrumental numbers, different aria forms, but it's not exactly holding together. The form of Esther in the 17-18 version is kind of clumsy. And it wouldn't be until Esther's revision in 1732 that we start seeing a more mature oratorial style. The 1732 performance was spearheaded by an unauthorized private performance or unauthorized public performance of the 1718 version. I know this is a lot of detail, but you know, Handel is just trying to create his own authorized version to make a buck out of, you know, so he could profit off his own labor, so to speak. And that sort of inspired him to do a couple more oratorios. A Deborah and Athalia would follow in the next couple of years. But, you know, he was still really trying to make opera work until that 1738 season. And it's only then really that we get a full scale devotion to oratorio. So that's a lot about the context of Israel and Egypt. I'm sure some of you are very, very, very curious to now learn about Israel and Egypt itself. First of all, I would say that the version that we most frequently hear now of Israel and Egypt is not the version that was first performed. You know, one additional complication of the 1737-38 season, you know, this is the one where Handel gets paralyzed. You know, there's the final pangs of the battle between Handel's company and the Opera of the Nobility, is that Queen Caroline dies. Queen Caroline is the wife of George II. She's quite beloved. When a monarch or the spouse of a monarch dies, you have to have a blackout period of having no theater, which isn't great if you're trying to make money. So what Handel did during that time was he wrote a gorgeous work, the Funeral Anthem for Queen Caroline, also known as The Ways of Zion Do Mourn. It's a relatively neglected masterpiece, and I want us just to listen to the opening chorus of the Funeral Anthem for Queen Caroline, The Ways of Zion Do Mourn. There's a reason we're going to listen to it other than the fact that it's great music. This is a performance by the English Baroque soloist and John Elliott Gardiner. really sublime work. Again, do listen to it. Quick question, put in the chat, does it, that work remind you of any other work? Specifically, I'm gonna sing the theme again. Da, 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 dee, dee. Does anyone recognize where that theme also pops up? Something of the Messiah, okay. Any other answers? I recognize it, but can't make it. Mozart, okay. We're getting somewhere. Let me put it in a different form. Requiem aeternam. Okay, so yes, the funeral anthem for Queen Caroline, the ways of Zion do mourn, and yes, Mozart Requiem, the introit, and also other themes in Mozart Requiem. Mozart did study that piece and draw from it. So I just thought that was a fun connection. In terms of what we're talking about today, if it was good enough for Mozart to draw upon for his Requiem, it was certainly good enough for Handel to reuse in his own work. He first considered using it in Saul. Ultimately, he deployed it as part one of Israel and Egypt. Which is perfect. You know, the funeral anthem is an occasional work in the sense that you know, that queen only dies once. It's unlikely that you're gonna get a chance to use it again. So it makes perfect sense for Handel to adopt it for Israel and Egypt. The texts drawn from the Old Testament, the books of Samuel, Job, Lamentations, Ecclesiastes, as well as Philippians from the New Testament, but just needed a little modification to fit this new context, which Handel titled as The Lamentations of the Israelites for the Death of Joseph. Joseph, according to the book of Genesis, was one of the 12 sons of Jacob / Israel, who went down to Egypt, not by choice, but he became very powerful. He saved the rest of his family from famine, but then they got stuck there and became slaves. So that's the whole setup. That's the whole shtick behind part one. And then we have two other parts in the oratorio, which was built as a compilation of Old Testament verses, most likely by Charles Jennens, the librettist of Saul and Messiah. So part two, as we'll talk about, deals with all the plagues that God inflicted upon the Egyptians to get them out of slavery. And then part three deals with the episode where the Egyptians are pursuing the Israelites, whom Pharaoh freed, pursuing them through the desert and into the Red Sea, which had miraculously parted and for the Israelites to cross. And then once they got over, the sea like collapsed back in on itself and killed all the Egyptians, and the Israelites celebrated. So that's all of part three. So part one is, we're sad Joseph died, now we're stuck in slavery. Part two is all the plagues. You can think of Charlton Heston, Ten Commandments. Part three is, oh, we're out of slavery, let's celebrate. I don't know, there's probably a much better summary you can get of that. But that is essentially the plot, if you will, of Israel and Egypt. And Handel worked backwards to draft this. So we know that part one was done, right? It's just a funeral anthem, slightly reworked. He started part three on October 1st, 1738, and finished his draft by October 11th. He started part two on October 15th and finished even quicker, only taking 5 days to do it by the 20th. He then filled out both parts by November 1st. So all in all, it took him exactly a month to compose parts two and three of Israel and Egypt. And we'll delve a little more into why it could be so quick in just a bit. For me, one of the most satisfying things about Israel and Egypt is the luxuriousness of its orchestration. You know, in opera, as we mentioned, most of the financial resources were devoted to the singers and to all the other special effects, scenery, which was often quite elaborate. That meant that there wasn't that much money left over for the orchestra. And the orchestration was generally quite sparse. You would have strings, you would have what we would now call a continuo section, that is a keyboard instrument, lutes, the oboes, kind of playing a chordal underpinning. And you would have like some winds, but they wouldn't play frequently, a small complement of winds. You might have one or two rare instruments in an opera here and there. But that's about it. You know, generally a very, very sparse texture because the primary drawing point were the singers. However, given that you didn't have to pay the singers as much to do oratorio and there's no staging, Handel instead decides to devote all of his extra resources into the orchestra. So not only do you have a double chorus in Israel and Egypt, so that's two SATB choruses, you also have an orchestra of trombones, trumpets, timpani, and, you know, a full complement of strings and winds. So, you know, it's a pretty rich orchestra for the Baroque, high Baroque period. And I thought it'd be now, you know, we've been talking so much about the work. Should we listen to a little bit of it? I think it'd be really fun. We're gonna just dive into a couple of numbers and we'll use them as springboards to talk about how Handel's powers are at work. Again, these performances are by the English Baroque soloist led by John Eliot Gardiner. We're gonna start with "He Spake the Word," the text of it being "He Spake the Word, and there came all manners of flies and lice in all quarters. He spake, and the locusts came without number and devoured the fruits of the ground." So let's see how Handel sets that up.
He spake the word.
Thank you.
always, you know, I find it so funny. It's just a perfect example of word painting, right? We literally hear the flies jumping about, right? And the furious writing for the strings, right? If you see it on the page, if you have, you know, even a piano reduction from you, it's just like a smattering of black. So those are all the flies and lice. It sounds elementary, but it's very, very effective. Yes, feel free to put in the chat what your comments are. Someone wrote, I have to go call the exterminator. I'll be back. what we have here is a very, very effective text painting and a very ingenious deployment of the orchestra, right? We hear the trombones, which kind of just a boom, 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 kind of prefiguring the chorus. Trombones have sort of a sacred context, so kind of them doing the declamation, boom, 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 he spake the word. You know, you kind of, audiences then would have kind of like heard, there is God speaking in the background. And then we have, you know, the winds kind of set up in juxtaposition, helping out with the chorus, sometimes doing their own independent things. It's just a kaleidoscope of colors, all set up to paint this text so vividly. And it sounds like a lot of work. It is a lot of work for the instruments, but it's so wisely wisely composed for the chorus. The chorus actually doesn't have that much to do there, but in the sense of it's not strenuous to sing, but the presence of it is very palpable. So, in my book, a really effective movement. I would pay a lot to write something like that. Let's listen now to another movement. The plagues are always great because they're so vivid. This is He Smote All the Firstborn. For those of you not familiar with the Old Testament of the Bible, the Hebrew Bible, it's pretty violent. So this is a plague, I believe plague number 10, the final one that convinces Pharaoh to let the Israelites go. So here is He Smote All the Firstborn.
Yeah.
It feels inappropriate to delight in such a savage piece, but let's dive into how Handel is setting it so effectively. I mean, it's sort of, I know the guillotine is a little bit later, but it feels like, right? That incessant, those quarter notes on every half measure, you can just hear so viscerally and feel the firstborn of Egypt, the chief of all their strength, being struck down. There's nothing like a big block of sound to do that. And contrasting that with the chorus, which is in a fugal form, right? He smote all the firstborn of, we have that melody, and then the chief of all their strength is a different melody. It's in very strict fugue. Like, this is the law of an angry God coming to get you, and there's no escaping it. You hear the snarl of the trombones accentuating that in this dark minor key. And it's you have all that going on, and it's suddenly in the middle of the movement when the roles switch, right? The orchestra gets the fugue stuff, and then the voices do, he smote the chief of all their strength. It's so fearsome. It's amazing that how Handel chooses to trade the material, and it's meant to be scary. It's again just a perfect marriage of text and affect and orchestration. So not that Handel only needs plagues to inspire him. I shouldn't say that. The plagues bring out the best in Handel. Let's look at the final chorus slash sort of soloist movement, The Lord Shall Reign. The text here is, the Lord shall reign forever and ever. Then you have two little solo interludes where they give you a little more context. And the chorus then gets, sing ye to the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The magnificent final chorus.
Thank you.
It is just, yeah, how can you not be drawn up out of your seat after singing that? Or, you know, I guess if you're singing it, how can you not fall back into your seat after singing it? I saw some of us, you know, singing furiously. And this is the last chorus of the entire piece. It's the second half of which is a reprise of Something Happened at the Beginning of the of that part. This section brings to mind for me the famous quote that Beethoven said about Handel, which is, go to him to learn how to achieve great effects by the simplest of means. There are lots of notes here, but the actual musical material is quite simple. So what Handel does in this section, right, is he sets up, it's sort of like doing once, twice, thrice, right? We get the Lord shall reign forever and ever. Very simple melody. It goes up, it goes down, goes a little higher, finishes. He does it three times. Like, it's like, let's just get on with it. Like the anticipation is building in you psychologically. And how he does that each time is he starts off really simple, right? The voice is very slow moving. And in the instrumental parts, it goes from like eighth notes to a little like more 16th notes. And then it brings it to a halt. So it's like every time you're gearing up, there's all these little elements. The harmony is very static. And that is true, even when we get to the part which is just, you know, a romp, all right? For he hath triumphed gloriously. Of course, you know, in typical Baroque fashion, there is a huge melisma or stream of notes on glorious. And it's breathless, right? All you're singing, right? The horse and his rider, the horse and his rider, exactly as you would being if you were both celebrating, but also like trying to get down from an adrenaline rush, right? Of having just escaped, you know, a band of marauding Egyptians who were threatening to drag you back into enslavement. It's just remarkable how that is done. You're singing lots of notes, but the basic theme, which we get here and there, right, is I will sing unto the Lord. 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 1. That's it. And that's just all of the other stuff is filigree that is built around that. So I think it's a perfect illustration of that, again, that Beethoven quote. Great effects, very simple means. Hopefully that inspires you to listen to the rest of the chorus. We're not done here. I just thought we would listen. And now I want to turn to a different topic, which is acknowledging Handel's borrowing. So what do I mean by this? So we've talked about how Handel repurposed the funeral anthem for Queen Caroline as the first part of the oratorio. As I said, that makes sense. It's a one-time work. Don't let good music go to waste, especially if there aren't recordings. No one has any idea what it sounded like anyways. Certainly for those of you who participated in our B minor mass semester in the fall, that's, you understand what's going on here, right? This idea of parody, of reuse, of taking a good material you have, reworking it. If Bach could do it, so could Handel. And a lot of other composers did that. However, Handel's reuse was perhaps on an altogether different scale. Frequently, he would just borrow wholesale, not only from himself, but from other composers. This would range from taking principal motives all the way to essentially whole movements, frequently with significant alteration, but still. we don't have time to fully dissect what, you know, like the range of Handel's borrowing procedures, but it would be safe to say that if we did this nowadays, if you and I had the audacity to do what Handel did, we would be accused of plagiarism to the highest degree. An important point to note here is that the idea, the notion of proprietary authorship, of like sheer originality being the prime consideration for greatness, is a concept that arose after Handel's time. You know, not to overgeneralize, but in Handel's time, invention was not the most important thing to in a consideration of greatness. Emulation and the refinement of emulation was just as important, if not more important. That said, it's on a very vast scale, so we need to have some reckoning with it. And maybe the best place to start is to see what did Handel borrow to create Israel and Egypt. Primary research in this area was first done in 1906 by the musicologist Sedley Taylor in his book, The Indebtedness of Handel to Works by Other Composers, A Presentation of Evidence. He discusses a lot of works in there, but the bulk of that book is devoted to Israel and Egypt, which tells us a lot. He built upon the research of the pioneering Handel scholar, Frideric Handel, who was the editor responsible for bringing Handel's works to kind of a first complete edition of printing, the Handel Gesellschaft. So building on Christender's works, Taylor found that a significant part of the first half, primarily the play choruses, came from a wedding serenata by Alessandro Stradella, who lived from 1643 to 1682. The coolest thing about Stradella is that he led a very dissolute lifestyle, which eventually led to his murder. This serenata, Qual prodigio e ch'io miri, forms the basis of several of the play choruses in Israel and Egypt. So let's listen to what Handel was borrowing from. So we're going to listen to the opening serenata, or part of it, or the sinfonia of the serenata. And this is performed by the Società Cameristica di Lugano in Switzerland, or the border of Switzerland, Italy. So we're just going to listen to a little bit of it. This is what it goes into is he gave them hailstones, which we're going to listen to right after. Enough of that. Let's listen to Handel / Stradella. This is He Gave Them Hailstones, which is a chorus, but we're going to mainly listen to the instrumental opening. You know, it's hard to not just keep listening, but it is totally the same. We start with a kind of bum bum, bum bum, bum bum, bum bum, dun 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 dun. What Handel does, though, I mean, first of all, the context is very different, right? One is the wedding serenata, the introduction to a wedding ode. I think most of us would not want to have hailstones pouring down on us and fire during our wedding. The contexts are completely different, right? First of all, let's put that aside. Stradella kind of takes that motive, which is just you have some rhythmic intensification, right? There are more notes as we go along, but essentially it's just like one harmony. But then he does it. He takes us like halfway, right? He gets it. He gets our engines going, and then he stops it. What Handel does is he starts it up, he gets it going, but rather than bring us to a full stop, he kind of puts it into a simmer that allows us to go into overdrive and launch into the chorus. For me, that is, yeah, sure, he borrowed. I mean, you can hear the first 30 seconds of it is note for note the same, just in a different key. But the effects and the intent is very different, and the development is very different. I'm not saying this is representative of all of Handel's borrowing. Some are more on the side of, you know, pretty cut and dry borrowing, and some is even more altered. But there is a significant amount of reworking going on. If you're going to join us for the rest of the semester, which I really hope you do, you know, we'll dive into more of the individual borrowings as we go movement by movement. But now I just kind of want to give you a laundry list just to show you how much of the rest of the piece was also borrowed. So in the first half, we had the Stradella. We also have Handel borrowing from himself, a couple of keyboard fugues. In the second half, we have a lot of movements derived from the Magnificat of Dionigi Erba, who was a random Milanese priest and composer, and also the Te Deum of Francesco Antonio Urio, who is also another Milanese priest and composer. Don't know what was going on in Milan and Handel, but the borrowings are there. The Urio Te Deum was also used in Saul, that other oratorio, 1738. L'Allegro, Penseroso, ed in Moderato, and the Dedigen Te Deum. These all were all works composed around the late 1730s, 1740s by Handel. Handel also borrows from his own Dixit Dominus. He borrows from one of his Chandos anthems. There's also littler borrowings throughout the work from Rameau, Kehl, which was a German composer of the earlier generation, Nikolaus Adam Strunk, another earlier generation German, and even Handel's own teacher. So maybe we should add their names to Handel's Israel and Egypt, but we won't. You know, it's a lot of it at least gets its genesis in the works of other composers. And you can imagine that a lot of ink has been spilled over the years about Handel's borrowings, you know, a lot of hand-wringing about it. During his lifetime, the funny thing though is there's really no evidence of any discussion about Handel borrowing. It's not like he hid it, it's just no one really talks about it. It really falls into the generation after Handel. Yeah, as just saw the chat comment, yeah, no one really cared, no one really noticed. As I said, expectations were kind of different. It fell to the generation after to kind of put the pieces together. Even in 1785, though, the great chronicler of music, Charles Burney, who knew Handel, said, "I know it has been said that Handel was not the original and immediate inventor of several species of music for which his name has been celebrated. But with respect to originality, it is a term to which proper limits should be set before it is applied to the productions of any artist." So he's saying, Handel might have borrowed. He didn't do everything originally, but let's be clear here. You know, originality is overused. Let's set our expectations. Like, he's kind of defending Handel, if you will. It's a relatively mild accusation. It would fall to the next generation yet again to get a little more serious about it. Samuel Wesley, who probably did his work in the late 1700s, early 1800s, said, Salomon, who was the great German English violinist and champion of Haydn, has said that truly and surely enough, the English know very little of the works of the German masters. Handel accepted, because he was German. And so Handel, when he remained in England, established a reputation wholly constituted upon the spoils of the continent. So he's getting a little more, finger wagging. He's saying, Salomon's saying, you English are idiots. I'm from a German speaking land as well. You know, Handel just borrowed and you didn't know any better. But, you know, still not really assigning any moral blame. And then in 1831, finally, we get like an expose. The musicologist and composer William Crotch kind of lists, there are 29 composers from whom Handel borrows. And here's some of the examples of that. And we've talked about the other like 19th century evidence finding around that. And, you know, we're always still finding more, right? There's more sources to discover. Looking forward closer to the present day, at least among musicologists, Handel's reputation, morally speaking, has fluctuated wildly because of this borrowing. Just now I'm gonna throw some names of musicologists. Andrew Porter called Handel the great arranger. John Roberts, not the Chief Justice, said, such adorned copying of another's work is usually associated with by theorists with lack of technical skill and lack of talent. It seems that Handel had a basic lack of facility in inventing original ideas. So essentially Roberts is calling Handel, second rate, if you will. And some people are like, get over it. You know, we've known this for hundreds of years at this point. And for me, the ultimate question really is, we can argue endlessly about the moral implications of Handel's borrowings, but does that really bring us closer to understanding Handel's greatness, if we think that's the case, of him as a creative musician? As the Handel scholar Ellen Harris writes, I'm willing to take bets that Handel was more than a great compiler. I mean, for me, it seems that, you know, what Handel does in Israel and Egypt as a whole, you can't take that away and break it down to its constituent parts. It just doesn't work. We've talked a lot about the work. Now we've talked about borrowings. I'm sure you're curious, this is such an amazing piece. It must have been such a hit the first time it was premiered. Turns out that was not the case. In fact, the first time Israel and Egypt was heard on April 4th, 1739, it was a flop. It was too long with the three parts. It was too full of choral numbers for audiences used to hearing lots of arias. A contemporary account stated that they did not have 20 people in the pit, being not the orchestra pit, but the audience. That is fewer people than are on this call right now, just to give you an idea of the attendance at Israel and Egypt. You know, there's many possibilities. There's also a possibility that the event was really poorly attended because it was politically not great. Israel and Egypt describes the oppression of the Israelites by the Egyptians. And, some scholars posit that it could have been read as anti-government propaganda and a metaphor for the ongoing dispute between George II and Frederick, Prince of Wales, which we talked about earlier. Frederick was supposed to show up at the premiere. He most likely didn't. I mean, Grant, all in all, he had a good excuse because he had a child being born around that time. But still, it didn't help Handel's audiences. And Handel prepared for the worst. He only scheduled two more performances, one a week after on April 11th, and then one 6 days later on April 17th. During those two performances, he cut down on the number of courses greatly, added four arias to try to get it, you know, more popular, but it didn't really work out. There's one more performance in 1740, and then the last performances in Handel's lifetime are in 1756, featuring large-scale changes done by Handel's assistant, John Christopher Smith. So when did Israel and Egypt become popular? It doesn't happen for another couple of decades. And I would say it began in earnest thanks to a revival that took place in London in 1784 for the so-called Handel Centenary. As you may know, Handel was born in 1685. So to do it in 1784 is a little weird. The reason for that is that Handel's first biographer, John Mainwaring, mistakenly got his birth year as 1684. So that's why we have a centenary in 1784. At any rate though, it was really a hit in those performances in London. And as choral societies began to flourish, amateur choral societies dedicated to singing large-scale works, Israel and Egypt, is perfect. You know, a lot of choral numbers. For Victorian audiences, it was a particularly effective combination of morality. And it became one of Handel's most popular works, rivaling the reception of Messiah. Before we head to the Q&A, I just want to play you. It's not the greatest recording in the world, but it is a very special recording. And the reason it's not, acoustically speaking, a great recording is because it's the earliest known musical recording ever made. It was made in 1888. It consists of one of the choruses, Moses and the Children of Israel. And it was recorded at the Crystal Palace in London, featuring, 4,000 singers and 500 instrumentalists. Fair warning, I mean, all you hear is a very, very faint echo. But even if one must use one's powers of imagination to conceive of 4,500 people making Handel's music come alive, I think it's just remarkable to peel back this veil of history just a little bit to listen. So if you'll indulge me, this recording, June 29th, 1888, selected choruses from Israel and Egypt. Thank you. So that is excerpt of the chorus, the last chorus, but Moses and the Children of Israel. So that is an introduction to Israel and Egypt. So at this point, I would love to invite any questions you may have, any comments, any stones that you want me to turn over, or just, you know, any random questions that may have arisen because of something I said. So yeah, that recording was on a wax cylinder, but it's quite, the grooves are quite faded at this point. And, you know, there have been different audio restorations done and enhancements over the years, but at this point, 150 years later, almost, it's 140 years later, there's not a lot of stuff left on it. The stamping of their feet is just the rolling of the wax cylinder being uneven. So just trying to get some of the questions that were in the chat. People would remember the work, just like, imagine, you know, you might get a tune stuck in your head if it's really good, but other than that, you have printed music. You can look at that if you could read music. Community choruses, that's a whole different topic. It's obviously people in singing, but primarily community choruses as we think of them now are really an invention of the early 19th century. We talked about the wax cylinder. Can we see everyone's faces? Yes, that's on you and not me. And was the borrowed material perhaps borrowed from some other prior composer? Yes, it's probably a stack of turtles all the way down to some degree. And but joking aside, it really goes back to a framework structured around rhetoric, in rhetoric, or at least in how they developed, a curriculum around it, invention is really only the beginning. The skills that were prized were a development of emulation, emulatio, of refinement. That was just as important as developing the whole new idea. It's only really now that we say, original, that means genius. Well, they didn't even really think of genius either. Overgeneralizing, but you know, it's a very different mindset. Any live questions though, feel free to unmute yourselves. don't be strangers.
I have a question. I have a couple, but I just realized that Handel's Dixit Dominus was written like 30 years before these. Mm-hmm. Startling to me, because I mean, to me, that Dixit Dominus is his greatest work, and I didn't realize he was so young when he wrote it. But anyway, did he borrow from his really early work, or because I'm not hearing a lot of that?
Handel's borrowing is pretty, it's pretty widespread. Are we talking about Sicily and Israel and Egypt, or in general?
Well, just in later, when he was doing Israel and Egypt and the Messiah, did he borrow from like his super early stuff, like the Dixit?
He did. He would borrow from the works of his youth, for example, like the works of Zakhal, his teacher. He was pretty indiscriminate. He would borrow from all over. I mean, if of course he would borrow from works that were closer, he would take one work and use it over several works written in the same period. But yeah, it's all over the place. Definitely a lot of the earlier works get reused and revised. For example, Il Trionfo, which was written in 1707, which we talked about, that first oratorio, gets reproduced at the very end of Handel's life with the help of his assistant John Christopher Smith as the triumph of Truth and Time, which is really a tongue twister to say. So yeah, it's a constant process.
It was also published as Triumph of Time and Truth.
I'm sorry?
That was also published as Triumph.
Yeah, it's I always forget. It's a lot of T's, and I always want to say tooth in one of them. But would he tend to borrow from material that had been critically acclaimed, popular? This is from Jared. Yes and no. I guess the idea of critically, this is a very lawyerly response, but I have a problem with the premise of critically acclaimed. Again, most of this music is traveling in a very small circle, transmitted primarily by manuscript form. What's really interesting about Handel is that he's borrowing from several generations behind him. He also sometimes takes works from his contemporaries and younger composers. It's very indiscriminate is not the word, but it's very wide ranging. It's eclectic. So, yeah, I don't know. Critically acclaimed. I mean, sometimes his works were critically acclaimed, and he borrowed from them. So, from himself.
So it was if he could use it, then he would use it, or if he needed it or it fit, then he.
Yeah, it just seems that for Handel, a large part of stirring his creative juices was having, you know, a score he was able to take from his library and for inspiration. I mean, that's just his work process. His work process was like that. Again, I don't, you know, Handel did it a lot more than other people, but other people were also doing this. I want to be clear that Handel wasn't the only person doing it. Yeah.
Well, it seemed like it took a great deal of skill to piece it all together.
Yeah, and it's not just piecing, right? Because as you can see in the Stradella, I just took one of, you know, several dozen movements. It's really a wholesale rewriting and taking, like, I don't think I would have imagined, at least my imagination probably would not have seen a wedding ode being transformed into Fire and Brimstone. I think I only use borrowing because it seemed like the most neutral term. It really doesn't capture the scope and the complexity of the issue at hand. And there's a lot of, as I said, there's a lot written on it. You can just type in Handel borrowing. Dozen articles, books. I mean, not that many books, like a couple books, but. Yeah, I mean, I'm curious how many people were really familiar with the scope of Handel's self-borrowing and borrowing from others before tonight? Seeing a lot of no's. Okay, good. It's just fun. I mean, I don't think it really changes, for me at least, you know, Handel's works are Handel's works. Anyone else? Well, you know, the perfect opportunity, I'm not going to dissuade you from asking more questions, but the perfect opportunity to ask me more questions after I do this is to come to the sessions following every Wednesday for the next 12 weeks, I believe, as we go into the movements one by one. You don't need to be, you know, you don't have to prepare every week for them. The joy of doing this is that you will have opportunities to do some virtual things, but you are not obligated. However, you are obligated to show up and just have fun and really enjoy the work. So that's an opportunity, a low key way to do this. And now back to more questions, if you want.
So if there's only a couple thousand people in London, I guess, who are the audience, is that right? Do they all like know each other? They're all like intermarrying, they're all.
I guess I could have dived into a context of that. you know, we often get competing narratives. One of the things we often hear about London, or about his turn into oratorio, was that he was diving into the middle class audience. The truth of the matter is, oratorio was priced almost the same as opera. So the idea that it was cheaper would draw in more people, first of all, that's a lie. We have evidence that that's not the case. Second of all, you can only afford a ticket if you could, your income was above like £600 or so, which £600 or so puts that number around 5,000 people.
Oh, wow.
In London at the time, in a city of about, I think at the time of Handel's life, about 600,000 people. So less than 1% of people. We're really talking the idea that Handel was, you know, beloved by the masses, true, but we're talking about a different century here. Mm-hmm. A century which had seen really a societal change. The development of having a hero composer, because in Handel's day, to be a composer was, you were definitely way below the singer, you know, for example. It's a very different conception of,
and for so,
him, a great composer is on us, kind of.
So these composers also all knew each other? It's like they all went to each other's concerts, or they trained at each other's schools, or, I mean, that was also a small group?
Yeah, it's a small group of people. I mean, they didn't, the idea of schools, I mean, they, you know, we have masters of composition, you know, they would know each other that way, or by a primary way of you weren't getting to know each other personally was by the transcription of manuscript scores, that there was a very active, the way you would get to know people is by getting a copy of their music, you know, a manuscript from either a copyist or from the composer. That's how works and composers develop their reputation, at least amongst each other. If they didn't know each other or ran in the same circles. Yeah, very different way of getting popular. And it's not popular, really. As I said, I think during the presentation at some point, Handel was creating elite music for the elite and trying to figure out what their tastes were. And he did a pretty good job. I mean, for most of his life.
So if a critic was going to write an essay or criticize a performance, uh-huh. I mean, how many people were literate enough to read it or could afford the newspaper?
People would read it. I mean, you do have a, you know, there are Handel documents you can go through, which, you know, there are published, you know, in newspapers and periodicals. People would read it. I mean, they just would never have
wouldn't have heard them, but they might have heard the music.
Yeah, they wouldn't have heard the music. It would be like, oh, we're reporting it, but we wouldn't have never heard it. Probably the widest range of people that could have heard Handel's music during his lifetime was the performance of the music for the Royal Fireworks in 1740, is it 8 or 9? I don't know, you can look it up. In that performance, we get an estimate of about 3,000 to 10,000 people.
Wow.
That's, you know, wow. Okay, that's a lot of people, but that's in the city of 600,000. So it's not by any means like top 40, you know.
You've been there.
Yeah.
So it maybe would have been great to write something that would be performed in church, right? Because then maybe there would more people hear it? Not necessarily. The churches weren't that big.
Yeah, I mean, we don't, it's unfortunately, I'm probably outside of the scope of this call to delve into what sacred practices. Handel did not write a lot for sacred contexts. It was for patronage purposes.
It was very, it seemed to me, you know, filling a political, like it was political in the sense that that's who he was writing for.
Yeah, I mean, Handel's career was intertwined a lot with the fortunes of the Hanoverians, who the Hanoverian monarchs, who were these Germans who took over the throne because, you know, the Stuart line died out, not yeah, the Stuart, yeah, died out. And yeah, they were like, we're these Germans coming into England. And here's another German coming to England. Hopefully we'll make this work. Yeah, it's very political. I mean, the idea of Handel being an English composer is a very political thing that's developed over 2.5 centuries.
Wow, thanks, Derek. I didn't know any of this.
I don't know if it's worth it. I mean, it's interesting.
It's interesting. Yeah. I didn't know any of this.
Endlessly fascinating. I mean, there's, if this, you know, if what I said interests you, there's excellent biographies of Handel readily available on the market. The man himself is sort of a mystery, but everything about, everything surrounding him, we have a lot of writing about.
And is there a version of the score, if we wanted to buy a score instead of using the PDFs that, that you sent out, that you'd recommend?
I this is what I have as a piano vocal score, which is a Novello.
Okay, thanks.
I mean, it was, the original printing, I think, was like in the mid 1800s. So it looks antiquated, but it works. And the you know, it's easy to open, and all the notes are there, and they're easy to read for the most part. So.
Great, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, obviously, please don't feel obligated to stay. I'm just here because if you have questions or comments, I want to answer them.
This has been really fantastic and very enlightening and exciting. I'm super excited about the sessions to come, and it's great to see everyone here. And thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Yeah, my pleasure. I hope it won't be, you know, I hope this is a fabulous start to what I'm sure will be a really fun couple of months diving into this work, so.
Well, thank you to Vallejo, the Choral Society, and thanks a lot, Derek. Thank you.
This is nice. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm
very nice start.
All right. Well, have a great rest of your night, everyone, and hopefully we'll see you next Wednesday.
Yes.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Get some rest.